Next speaker, Mr. Tamal Bandyopadhyay, is an Indian business journalist and is known for his weekly column on banking and finance called Banker's Trust in Mint. But that isn't why he's here with us today. He's here with us today because he has chronicled the journey of India's only bank that emerged in eastern India after independence, the Bandhan Bank. It is a phenomenon that should make us all proud. His book is the personal story of a boy, Chandrasekhar Ghosh, who grew up in small town Agartala, struggled through poverty, but remained steadfast and relentless in his ambition to make it big. He battled competition, hostile money lenders, he battled corruption, hostile money lenders, a tough economic climate, and the perpetual lack of resources. But on 17th June 2015, he was amply vindicated when he walked out of the RBI with a much coveted banking license, beating some of the country's top corporate Goliaths. By 2016, Bandhan Bank was launched with 6.7 million small borrowers. To walk us through Mr. Ghosh's journey, we have in conversation with Mr. Tamal Bandyopadhyay, Mr. T. Bijoy Idicheriah. Mr. Idicheriah is a financial journalist with Cogenix Information Services and it's currently its chief of bureau. He has been honored with the City Journalistic Excellence Award in 2016. He is also an active theater enthusiast and has been closely associated with Shoestring Theater and Loudmouth Entertainment for over a decade. May I now have both the guests on the stage.
Good afternoon, everyone. I hope I'm audible. Unlike my previous speaker, I'm not going to make an introduction of Tamalda. Instead, I'm going to tell you an anecdote, and I don't think Tamalda even remembers. This is 2009. I'd been working with my company. I've been with the same company for 11 years, and Tamalda's team called me for an interview. Tamalda was with Mint at that point, as in actively running the Mumbai operations. And I got an interview, I did the whole interview, at the end of which Tamalda said, so what are you doing now? And I said, I've just moved last week from doing commodities to banking. And Tamalda was offering me a job to track commodity companies, and he said, then why do you want to leave that? And that is why I stayed on where I did. I refused the offer from Tamalda's team at that point. But that little bit, that advice that came from when he said, you're going to do banking, as in you should do banking, was his piece of advice. And that's why I've always had the greatest regard for Tamalda. Wonderful to be able to catch you in conversations here today. Just because we're talking about your books, but let's not restrict ourselves to only Bandhan. You've written about HDFC Bank, and you've written about the Sahara issue before. Can you just take us through the process with which, one, you identify a topic, and then how you go about researching and working forward so that, you know, all the things come together so that there is a narrative to tell? I've heard you say many times in the past that you wanted to do another book, and then this book happened. So how does the whole process work for you as a storyteller?
Well, I'm not very sure whether I'll be able to explain to you exactly, because there's no conscious effort involved. Because, as a journalist, I am in the so-called knowledge profession. And so you always look for stimulation outside. So what do you do? Apart from writing your own stories, and then when you become senior, writing your columns and managing people. Managing first maybe 5 people, then 10, then 50, 60, whatever. And then it becomes a sort of drudgery where we don't know when the sun sets. You leave home at 9 and reach home back by 9 or 10, even if you are not going to press club for a booze. Just work keeps you for 12 hours. So you always look for intellectual stimulation. Then what do you do? Probably you do little, other kind of banking related events that I was doing. Then you start doing something, given an opportunity on television channels, discussions, etc. And then also certain times I used to get invitations to write certain, like for instance, Oxford book on Indian economy, which is sort of reference book. I had a couple of chapters there. So you were in the same way, it's in this so-called knowledge profession, but doing little things which always keeps you engaged, and as I said, it works like a stimulant or whatever you call it. And then the first book, which is called A Bang for the Buck, came from the publisher. Jayco was the publisher, and then they asked me. Apparently, they did some research at the B schools in India and figured out the subject which the B school students want to read about is the HDFC group story. And they said that probably you could do it, you are the right person, etc., etc. And then I said, why not? Let me try it out. So it was difficult to convince Deepak Parekh and Aditya Puri, because when you're writing a book, you need to have those people on board, because you need loads and loads of information. It's not writing a 500-word story or a 1,200-word column. It's about 70, 75, 80,000-word book. And it has to be accurate, because in Indian context, all the corporate entities and people, they take books very seriously. You can get away by writing a story which with factual inaccuracies by carrying next day some corrections. But in a book, it's for posterity. So you always run the risk of being sued, etc., etc., which happened in my case. I'll come to that later. So once I convinced there is a listed entity, so I presume they needed the board approval, etc. But I also set my rules that, look, no interference from your point of view. I am not bound to show you the script. You can crucify me if I go wrong anywhere. But you need to give me information what I want. You need to spend time with me. So, and this, what you call it, research, which is essentially one part of his shifting through the papers in case of listed entities, many, many published articles and many documents, annual reports, etc., etc. And also meeting people at every level, meeting your customers, meeting your employees, meeting your investors, meeting the regulators, and across India. Not restricted to any particular geography. So, but that I don't do as a separate thing. It's on the job. When I'm on the job, I am doing my daily job, but I always carry a tape recorder or whatever, you know, and taking notes or etc. So that's a process which takes probably a year or so, or, you know, depends on the subject. So you are on the job, you are doing that and all. And then typically I take a 2 months break. That's what in the first place. In Mint, we had a system of, taking a break for book writing. It's a paid leave.
Oh, very nice.
And for the first 7 years, I did not take any leave for 6 years and all. So I was, my editor was happy. I mean, they granted me a two weeks leave, and I had a place, little place in Goa, a friend's place. So where I actually shut myself from the outside world, with all the material in place in the form of CDs and or transcribed, etc., etc. So I write there, and every chapter I end up doing, I earn a bottle of beer or a little bit on the beach. So that's how it happens. So it doesn't take, it has never taken 2 months. It's about 6 weeks, 5 weeks, I close it. And every chapter I close, my son was young, and now he's in his early 20s, but that time he was even younger. So I used to mail him, and I used to tell him that, he is the first reader, how do you feel about it? And
for
he will
all
get
your books? All your books?
First two books. Okay. Third book, then he got into, he's now overseas studying. So I could not do because of his pressure and all. But first two books I do. So he reads from a teenager's and then early 20s point of view. And he gives this feedback that I have not been able to understand this, or I can't visualize this. So the objective, what I believe as a journalist and as a writer, both when I'm writing news stories, when I'm writing column, and when I'm writing book, to tell a story which is intelligible to, if I say grandma, then you will say I am a gender bias, my grandfather, and a school kid of 8th standard or 9th standard. So if I am not able to do that, then I am a complete failure. If I am writing on finance only the finance professionals can understand what I am writing, then I am a disaster. It should be appreciated by non-finance guys, it should be appreciated by anybody, a homemaker and a school kid. Incidentally, I don't have any finance background, I am a student of English literature. So his feedback that I can't follow this, or I don't understand this, or I can't see this man. Often he says, I can't see. I said, how do you make you see? He said, that's your problem. You have to make me see this man. So then I put in little things. Of course, I don't get back to him. I could understand. Initially, I could not understand. But then I understood that's what he's looking for. Maybe his coat is unbuttoned or buttoned. Or maybe he's wearing sneakers or black shoes. Or what's his height? Or is he fat or lean? Or does he have mustache or not? The little, you know, ingredients and all. So that's how. That's the entire process. Then I come back and then I revisit probably a week or so. And it's over. It's over. So I don't get intimidated that it's a book, oh God, how do I write 70, 80,000 words? I see it like is an 70 or 80 columns writing. You know?
That's your approach.
Yeah, that's the approach. So mentally I do the structuring and then I go about. So otherwise you feel very intimidated that how, oh God, how do I finish it? But here it's pretty easy. I don't see it's pretty cool. I mean, there's no problem.
You actually preempted two of my questions. But apart from your son, who is your other sounding board? As in the beginning, your publisher doesn't come in. But apart from that, once the whole narrative is in place, who is your sounding board? Do you have a sounding board when you start thinking about the book itself, or is it after you've started writing because you don't want to be influenced too early?
No, the theme, as I said, the first subject was given to me by the publisher. Second subject was chosen by me. And third subject was also chosen by me. Second subject, somebody else told me. Somebody, a very senior in Indian context, I would not like to name the person. I said, why don't you pick up Sahara, discuss about it. So that's the... And third is... I'll come to that later. No, there is no other, because my wife, she is more into singing and other things and social activities, meaning social activities, meaning not socialite, social, professional social worker. Okay. For construction laborers, children, and those kind of work she does. So she doesn't have interest in finance. She reads after the book is published.
Okay.
So it's first two books, my son was the first reader. Third book, no, there is no first reader. Because by that time, I'm also getting experience. Probably, you know, I know how to tackle this.
As in, you've been an editor for most of your life. How brutal are you during your own editing process? Because it's easy when you tell a story to get carried away with the story. We always, as reporters, we always get carried away because it's our story, our baby. When you're doing something of the magnitude of 75, 80,000 words, how difficult is it to then step back and start editing at the first level with you itself?
No, I think it's what is important is whether you want you have the clarity of thought. So many of us, I think you don't have the clarity of thought. So which is why also the financial sector reporting becomes very complex. A lot of people don't understand. Either we go by somebody says that, so we said, he said, or she said, etc., etc., without even an understanding.
Correct.
Or sometimes we get carried away by, you know, certain jargons and etc., etc. So it's very important that we need to have a clarity of thought. And if you have a clarity of thought, and if you are ethical in your approach, and by being ethical, I mean you need to be clinical. It's in this context, it's interchangeable, ethical and clinical, because
correct.
You need to be objective, what should be there and what should not be there, and what are the ingredients have to be there. You need to be very, very, very objective in that, so that there is the question of ethics comes, and so you need to be very clinical in his approach. So then it's not, as I said, if, at the end of the day, it's the clarity of thought that matters. I don't know whether I have that, but I think that's the case. Whether writing a news story or a column or a book, you need to know what you are going to do. There's no scope for being confused and then, you know, seeking others' help, because you are the creator.
Correct.
So the buck stops at you. You have to take, and you have to be responsible. You have to take the responsibility of what you're doing.
Because you said the buck stops with you. Bang for the buck. Your first book.
Yeah.
easily one book that opened up HDFC Bank to the real world, Aditya Puri, everybody clearly spent time with you on that book.
Yeah.
That is the big book. That is the big bank that today is the most market capitalized bank.
Yeah.
Then you had Sahara. And now you're writing about, you're also personally involved with Bandhan Bank as for disclosure purposes.
Yeah.
But you're writing about a small entity that in 2002, its ambition was to have one branch at each station.
Yeah.
Okay, 22 stations. That was what their ambition was for a decade.
Yeah.
And 10 years later, they had a bank in place. How different is it to write about an HDFC bank from writing about Bandhan?
No, I don't think it's anything difficult or different. The process is the same, you know. You, as I said, I have a very clear-cut idea what I'm going to do. I have clarity. I want to tell a story. I want to tell a story which is intelligible to a homemaker, to a school kid, to my grandfather. So to tell a story, there are different stories. HDFC Bank is India's finest bank and the most valued bank and one of the most valued banks in the world, hugely respected.
Correct.
So that's a story, and it's a child of liberalization. 1992, true. 91 liberalization, 93 it was born. So I looked at that way. Then Sahara is an investigative story. There are a lot of curiosity. It's a mystery. What's this, the former RNBC residuary non-banking company does? Where does it get the money? How does money comes, etc., etc.? Of course, it's very complex, complicated wave and all. But again, telling a story. Bandhan, again, it's a unique story because I have not dealt with the bank, Bandhan. I have dealt
Correct.
With the journey to become a bank. I found it's fascinating because, as this lady in the introduction said, a gentleman from Tripura, originally from Bangladesh, doesn't have the right kind of background because in India you have individuals getting a bank license backed by institution is Mr. Uday Kotak, which
Correct.
Is a completely different background, or you have Rana Kapoor,
Correct.
Again, which is a completely different background. They are all highly educated in the financial sector. They have the background of running a bank or financial institution. All this man is a very different kind of background. And I was watching him from sitting in Mumbai, even though I am originally from Kolkata, but I am out of Kolkata for the last 30 years. And I just visit there either at somebody's wedding or some friends or closes. Yeah, social occasions or death. That's the kind of thing. So I didn't know him personally. But I was watching this man. What was fascinating is, apart from giving loans to small entrepreneurs and lakhs and millions of women, also giving jobs to thousands of people. And you have to see in East, particularly in West Bengal, it's a very politically sensitive place. Unemployment is a raging issue over there. No, the entrepreneurship is restricted to running auto rickshaws and selling momos on the pavement. That's the kind of entrepreneurship we have seen in West Bengal. And it's a very politically volatile state. So sitting in that, operating from that particular area, geography in India, giving 12,000 people jobs, I'm talking about as a microfinance entity, now it's 20,000 plus, and insulating yourself from political forces and trade unions, etc. So I thought it's a story needs to be told. And that's the thing. So all the three has a story element in it. And how do I say? So there's no difference at all. It's the same weave is the same.
So when you tell a story, how do you balance the individual and the institution? Because it's been the case in all three of your books that there has been an individual, a strong individual as part of the story, and there is the institution that they have either been part of or they have, you know, founded. Also, how important is that, like you've kind of covered it, but how important is the social construct? For example, especially for Bandhan, because you mentioned it, it doesn't have a union. To manage without a union, and like you say, it's bettered the lives of all those people. If whoever's read the book will know that you say that. How important is it to cast it in the right social milieu while also focusing both on the institution and the individual?
Now, in some sense, individual and in all the three cases, individual and institutions, there is the dividing line is pretty blurred. Because even now, from 1993 to 2017, about 14 years, HDFC is Aditya Puri's bank. 24 years. And when I wrote, it was 21-year-old. So that's the thing, 3-4 years back.
Correct.
So HDFC is Adityapuri's bank.
Correct.
You know? Yeah, Deepak Parekh is the man who actually built, who brought Adityapuri, and then it's run by Adityapuri.
Correct.
Not too many people know who is the second person, who is the third person, or nobody else. So in some sense, you know, the ethos, the culture, etc., everything is built by this gentleman. You like it or not, that's a different issue altogether. How long he should be there, that's a separate story altogether. But this is... The entire branding, the entire institution is identified with this gentleman even now after 24 years. So it's intertwined. The story of the institution and the individual is intertwined. Similarly, Sahara, what it is, Subrata Roy. Do anybody knows its children about more about? I mean, about do you know about that his children and what is what do they do and all?
Not except not their much wedding.
Known. Yeah, except their weddings. Yeah. So again, Sahara is all about Subrata Roy. The ethos, the culture, and the mystery. Everything is about this man. So when I try to, it's a portrayal of the institution as well as the individual, and it's somewhere intertwined. And same is the case with Bandhan, even after becoming a bank. Is the story of this gentleman. Of course, there are people who were there. So what I do always is this, I don't make it a one-person show. In all the cases you will find, except for Sahara, because Sahara's case was slightly different. It's actually one-man show, there's nobody else. But whether it's HDFC, whether it's Bandhan, it's not a one-person show. There are other other persons also, right from the beginning. They have their own contributions. So whether like in Bank for the Buck, we have a chapter on Adityapuri, the person, and also a chapter on the top 12 people who from the beginning where have been with him and built the institution. Similarly, in Bandhan also, it talks about Mr. Chandrasekhar Ghosh, the founder, and also it talks about the first 10 individuals and the first woman employee who came and he built the sand. So it's not a hero worship. It's not a pumping for an individual and doing a PR work for him. I think whatever the person's relevance, I admit that and give the person's relevance. And whatever the, but not at the cost of others who are along with him. So I want to be fair. I mean, to the best of my knowledge, I think I'm pretty fair in this.
Okay. Before we go to the defamation part, but how have been the reactions when people have read what has been written about them? In Bank for the Buck, you talk about the uncomfortable fact that a lot of the second layer at HDFC Bank moved on when they realized that that space is, the top job is not up for offer anytime soon. In Sahara, you talk about all the people who got, who paid the price for the rise of Sahara. You talk about, C.S. Ghosh's case, you were writing about someone you're working with, you know, associated with even now. So how have been the reactions and how have people reacted to you when they have read what has been written about them?
See, it's a individual reaction. I would not be able to know in private what they're doing, but I'm sure they would not be extremely happy with it, because you know, when as an individual, as a person, I'm not very sure whether I would like you to talk about the critical aspects about me, if I have any, I would like you to focus only on the positive aspects. But what I try to do as an individual, as an institutions, it's all about, you know, both positive and negative. So even Adityapuri was fighting with another employee for a secretary. That's been mentioned over there. Or HDFC Bank had to face penalty from Reserve Bank of India for a breach of certain norms, etc. were there. And of course, people leaving. Now, is Adityapuri extremely happy about it? I'm not very sure. But what I look at it is, as long as I am doing it fairly, and as long as the facts are true, I'm not doing my job properly. I'm being extremely unfair to the readers. So that's how. Even in Bandhan Bank also, Mr. Ghosh is a benevolent despot. The way he operates, the way he, you know, he's a strict disciplinarian. Certain things, I'm sure he would not like.
Give me your Sundays.
Yeah, he forces people to work on Sundays. He used to say that, you give me your Sunday, I'll give you future. Yes, he has given them future, but he has made them work also Sundays. And I have not projected him as a god for the poor man, etc. This book, entire thing, talks about how you balance doing good and doing business. So, and there are a contrasting characters with two other entities I spoke about. One is the basics, which wanted to only, got carried away by the social zeal, whatever, entrepreneurship zeal, doing good to the people, and it could not succeed. Similarly, SKS in the previous avatar, it became too greedy to meet the investors' demand, and it became a victim of that. But Bandhan did a balancing act. So Chandrasekhar Ghosh, it has been projected as a very businessman, very astute entrepreneur, not as a god of the poor, for the poor people. So I don't know whether you like it, whether he would like it or not. Yeah. But do I actually care for it? I'm not very sure, because as I said, I've already faced a 200 crore defamation suit against me. So yes, come on, join the queue and file another case. I'll fight it. What else? I mean, as long as I am being truthful to facts, I will not be able to care for their sentiment, because ultimately it is my call what I would write.
Correct.
That's it.
It's my byline, as you would
say.
But just to again go back to the defamation case, because we've brought it up, what was your first reaction? Were you surprised? Because Sahara had opened itself up to you. He gave you an interview.
Yeah.
And then after that, and Subrata Roy, I called him Sahara for some reason. But anyways, Sahara Shri, as he's called, opened himself up, gave you the interview.
Yeah.
And after that, suddenly there was a change.
Yeah.
And then there's a defamation case.
Yeah.
You obviously hadn't sent them the transcript. So what was your reaction? Angry, scared, or were you just saying, you know, give me a chance to, you know, explain what the whole scene is? As in, how did you react to that?
See, a lot of things I can't be extremely open and transparent in this case, because you know, there's a legal history behind it. But to the extent I can just say, first, for me, writing any book is not a guerrilla warfare. You always give the other side a fair chance to give their point of view to the extent. So the first thing I did, I spent some time with Mr. Subrata Roy, 2 days exactly, at his Sahara Sahar, the place. I interviewed him. I played back the interview to him, etc., etc. And then there were continuous dialogue with his people, with his communications divisions, exchange of photographs, corrections, so on and so forth. Did I send him the transcript? Certainly not. I did not, because as I said, I am not obliged to send you the transcript. This is my project. None of the book is a sponsored project. I have not taken 1 rupee from any of them. So it's all my project and the publisher's project. And before the book was published, there was a festival, book like this kind of literary festival in Delhi, India Habitat Center. And when the book was in the Kacha format, it has not come out.
Correct.
I was invited to talk about the book. I spoke there, and the India Today group asked me for a chapter whether they could carry. And I think it's Business Today carried one chapter. Much before the book was published. And I was overseas for some work. And I came back, and my publisher, he wanted to see me, and we met in a hotel. And he said, he was trembling like this. He said, look, I have been slapped with a 200 crore case. I'm sorry, I'm dumping this. I cannot move with this. What exactly happened is this, after this book was, this chapter was published, they asked for a copy of the book from my publisher. And my publisher, without checking with me, he sent a copy of the book. And then they filed a court case in Kolkata High Court. And I was served a notice in in Hindustan Times office in Kolkata. And probably nobody knows me there. So the notice never came to me. And their person is, this is my office for profit. That's why they served it. And essentially, so I'll be inconvenienced. Had it been in Bombay, I'll be in a better position to fight in Kolkata, I would not be. But the publisher, as a party to it, he has published. And that's how it happened. And it's in the public domain now. Their script says that apparently Mr. Roy or whoever from the Sahara group was in Kolkata, and they found a book on the pavement near museum or somewhere, and they read the book, and they found that this book is full of defamatory content, etc., etc. And it also said that they called me and I admitted that, yes, this is the mistakes I made. And I asked for something which an organization of Sahara stature cannot accept. So the implicit meaning was that I asked for a bribe or whatever it is, so yeah, kind of thing and all. So my publisher was shaking and he said, look, I cannot fight. So I just asked him to cool down. We had a cup of coffee in a Parel hotel and I told him, give me 24 hours, what do I do? Then I had my friends in legal circle, etc., etc. They said, look, you don't have to bother about this. You don't have to pay anything. We'll fight for you. And my organization said that you invest time following this case, we'll excuse you from daily work. That's how it happened. So my cost was the logistics cost, like catching a flight and all kind of things. But the legal community fought for me absolutely pro bono. I did not charge anything. My office, my editor was extremely generous to give me this thing and all. And it was quite a traumatic thing. So there were a lot of advice on me to give up, because as an individual, it's not possible to fight an organization like Sahara. Some people thought I'm mad, I'm crazy. I lost weight. A lot of gray hair I got around that time, because it was not a happy state of affair. In fact, there's a book has come out. It came out last year. Soli Sorabji launched it in Delhi, which is a chapter on my fight with Sahara. Correct. And it's a unique in India and probably in the world where a defamation suit was filed even before the book was published. Because they said that even though the book is not published, the proofreader, the editor, etc., etc., they read it. So the press should be sealed, the copy should be destroyed, 200 crore money has to be deposited in an escrow account, and if I get delayed, some 17% interest have to be paid. And the first day when it came up for legal, this thing in Kolkata High Court, the judge said that my lawyer is a very eminent lawyer, he asked for the book to be published and then the court case to be on. This judge said that, I'm sorry, you can't play around with somebody's fame. You have to ask your client to put in 200 crore in an escrow account, then only I'll give you the go ahead. So we had to move from a single bench to division bench, and finally we were planning to move Supreme Court, and then there's a sort of out of court settlement. Yeah.
Were you happy with, at some point you said that there was some content that you agreed to take out.
Yeah.
Only because you said that it didn't take the narrative forward.
Yeah.
I don't want you to tell me what you took.
I was happy in the sense you never know that how long it would continue in Indian context. I was very keen that the book gets published. I was getting offers from various publishers, even overseas also, to back the book. So my publisher did not give up. He also stood behind me. And unlike me, for me there was no cost involved. Publisher, the cost was his cost, because the law firms are not fighting for him pro bono. Free, yeah. So he put his in more money and all. So when the red flag, when the white flag came, I was happy, but this is a very long drawn out process, even the discussion, the thing and all. So they wanted many things to be removed, which of course I put my foot down, I was not willing. There are a couple of instances, probably exactly two instances, or probably three, I think it's two instances, which would be not even 1% of the book, which will be, suppose, say 400 words out of a 75,000 word book, so a few basis points of such. And those things I dropped because they were not, even by dropping those couple of paragraphs, it did not harm the actual flow of the book.
Correct.
It did not contribute hugely to the content of the book. And had I stuck to it, it would have been difficult for me to prove those two couple of points without involving the persons involved, and I did not want to expose those people who told me those things in confidence to the outside world. So that's a simple logic.
Protecting your sources.
Yeah, protecting my sources. And of course, we got a unique formula for this thing, where I had to carry it a rejoinder by Sahara in a very prominent way, saying this book is all defamatory, etc., etc. And that's it. So it's a unique thing in the global publishing history. There is no book as published which says that this book is rubbish and defamatory. Yeah.
No, which is why the defamation case will be remembered, like you said, you know, Solisar Abji's book. But
yeah,
that defamation case,
that book, that book is called Sue the Messenger. It's came out. It's an Amazon, I think, this thing. Somebody from Bangalore, two persons wrote about it. There's a chapter, 37-38 page chapter on my fight with Sara.
Interesting. Let's just, you know, go back to Bandhan and that book particularly. How important was it that Bandhan had the universal bank license? Now we've seen a small finance bank license being issued. And you, I've seen you in many fora convincing and explaining to people that no, Bandhan is not a small finance bank. We do small loans, but we are not a small finance bank.
Yeah.
How important was it that Bandhan gets a small finance bank license from this way the whole banking sphere in India is changing? Because now we have 23 new banks out there, as in licenses that have been issued. So how important was the fact that Bandhan should get a universal bank license and not a small finance bank license?
No, I mean, first of all, the license when Bandhan got, the concept of small finance bank license was not there. It was the last of the universal, not last, after that also it's come on record. So if you see Indian banking history, it's a very repressive financial system. We have this bank nationalization 69, around that time, 69, 70. And after that, the first set of 10 banks came up in 1993. And all of them did not survive. Then you had to wait for 10 more years. 2003, there are two more banks, which is Kotak Mahindra and Yes Bank. And then, sometime 2011, Pranab Mukherjee announced in the budget that Reserve Bank of India would be giving licenses to new banks. So the concept of small banks did not arise at that point of time, because we are talking about universal bank, that was the Indian concept, right?
Yeah.
And RBI also probably caught unawares, because that was the time when Subbarao was the RBI governor, talking about consolidation in banking sector, not new players.
Correct.
If I am not mistaken, Finance Ministry took the call and informed Reserve Bank of India after that, before the budget announcement. So RBI came later and all. And then there was a question of whether corporations would be allowed to enter into banking or not. Probably, the government was in favor of allowing big corporations to be allowed, and Reserve Bank of India was not in favor of. And globally, there is nothing called right or wrong, because there are some countries corporations allowed, some countries
correct,
not. But so, Subbarao dragged his feet. From 2011, he was just, you know, taking time to formulate the discussion paper, licensing norm, etc., etc. And finally, he came out with the licensing norm in such a way which will make extremely inconvenient for corporations to get into banking.
Correct.
Because you need to follow a step-down subsidiary model. You need to expose your entire entity to the glare of RBI, etc., etc. So we found that like entity like Tata applied for it, but then withdrew and all. So you had 26 odd applications, two of them I think probably they withdrew, 24 with L&T and LIC, Housing Finance and India Post, so on and so forth. The objective of this licensing was financial inclusion, that's what the budget statement said, right? Earlier it was to bring in competition and more players, this time is financial. Now who else would you get with that kind of track record, 10-year track record, and doing well? So Bandhan was probably an automatic choice, even though it was not known and it came as a surprise.
Correct.
And IDFC was the other entity which was struggling with this
existing model
EFI, of infrastructure. Yeah. It was trying to do a lot of things. It was Macquarie of India, etc., etc., but laden with infrastructure loans and bad assets. So for IDFC, it was a sort of rescue act. Had you not allowed IDFC to become a bank, you would have folded up or did something else.
Had to be bailed out again.
So, yeah. So, these are the two entities. And the concept of small finance bank had not come. Probably, had Bandhan not applied for it then, and you would have applied later, you would have got into small finance bank. Having said that, even though Bandhan has got a universal banking license, it is not into corporate loan. If you see, so by choice, and in fact, in my, I have a chapter on the future of Bandhan, where I mentioned that if it wants to do well, probably it should stick to its core strength, not get into the corporate financing, because competition is pretty tough. Can it compete with the existing big bank switches into big way into corporate financing? Probably not. And why do you want to compromise on your core strength? That's the small loans. You should continue with that. So it's now 1.5 years. I think 95-96% of its assets, it's continued to be a small finance banks. I mean, small loans. And I think in spirit, probably in the next few years it will continue to that do. I mean, not in, I mean, in actual the business, it will continue to do the same thing. So in some sense, at this point of time, it's a universal small finance bank.
That's a nice nomenclature there. But when you talk about the book in Bandhan, when you talk about C.S. Ghosh's from Shobha Bazaar, where he got the idea, there's also one interesting point in the book where he's working for Village Welfare Society. And then immediately, he also registers Bandhan. There's that interim period where technically he's part of two organizations. You have not expounded.
I think there's a small film, a couple of two, 3 minutes film I gave it to them. Is there any organizer there? So that explains in a lot of answers you will get there, which you should have gone in the beginning itself. Since you asked me, probably it gives a, is it there? Can it be shown in? It's a very small film. It gives the business model very, very clearly. But again, as I said that, I mentioned that, that he was working in a particular organization, but he kept his resignation letter in the drawer, and the day he was caught, he put in. Now, would he like this to be done? I'm sure he would not like it to be told to the world. But I thought, for honesty and truthfulness, as an author, I must tell the world and you take your call. That's the objective. That's the entire objective. Can it be shown?
Okay.
Tell us when it's ready.
Just starting.
Okay.
Whenever.
So yeah,
set it up.
It explains lot of questions you are asking. It's I think three and a half minute thing. It gives the answer to this. So I think visual has a more appeal than conversation. Maybe 3 minutes. After that, again, still you if you want to. I mean, you can. I'm sure you can have many more. But sit.
Great financial illiteracy, it's refreshing to have a book written by somebody very literate about matters relating to finance. And I urge you to read the book and learn for yourself what has happened in the last 20 years.
This is Tamal's inimitable style of writing, which is direct to the point and always, you know, what I call newsworthy, in a way that it keeps you engaged.
Sahara, the untold story, a much disputed book, is finally set to release soon. A book which talks about 30 years of Subroto Roy, and Sahara is set to bring to fore a whole new saga. The book has details of closed-door conversations of Subroto Roy. Here's Tamal Bandyopadhyay, the author of the book.
Sahara India Parivar has not been happy with the content of the book. They had strong reservations. It is a journalistic work. And I can tell you, I have not compromised on my ethics and integrity and honesty. Every character in this book is real.
You must be wondering, what am I doing at the Dadar Sabji Market in Mumbai? Well, in a similar market at Shobha Bazaar, North Kolkata, the idea of Bandhan was born sometime late 1990s. Chandrasekhar Ghosh, the founder of Bandhan, was watching women sabji sellers at the market, taking money 500 rupees each from a man on his bike every morning and giving him rupees 5 on the spot. The same gentleman would come back in the evening to collect his 500 rupees. Ghosh wondered, why were they paying so much of interest? 5 rupees on 500 for half a day? 730% for a year? Those women told Ghosh, they are not paying any interest to this man. They're just offering him a cup of tea. Besides, where would they get the money? India's banks would not touch them. They don't have the collaterals. Neither do they know how to prepare the paperwork. And they don't have the time to go to the bank. Here's a gentleman who delivers the money at their doorsteps. That was the eureka moment for Ghosh. That's how Bandhan was born. Bandhan, the making of a bank, is just not yet another book on microfinance. It doesn't romanticize microfinance. It doesn't project microfinance as an agent of social change. It's about entrepreneurship. Ghosh is an astute entrepreneur who saw the gap in the Indian banking system and used it. He has mastered the art of doing business profitably at the bottom of the pyramid. That's what makes the Bandhan story unique. This is about making money available to the poor who are not touched by the banking system and doing this profitably. This is a compelling story of entrepreneurship, my dear reader. I'm sure you like it. If you don't blame the story. Blame the storyteller. Thank you.
In a period of...
Thank you so much. That is brilliant.
Actually, I forgot about this. When you spoke about Soba Bazaar, it just struck me.
You know, I was there for the launch, so I remember the... But anyways, Bandhan is, like you mentioned, it's not glorifying microfinance, but it also talks a lot about how microfinance has impacted people's lives. How especially it comes up in the Eastern province. So I was at an RBI training in earlier part of this week, where they said nearly 40% of all the NBFCs in West Bengal and nearly 70% of all the NBFCs in the northeastern states are either distressed and may lose their licenses because they can't even cough up 2 crore capital. In that scenario, how important is the story of Bandhan and how important was it to tell the story? But also from the perspective of eastern savings, there was Sarada that happened immediately. There was Andhra happening. So Bandhan continued to grow throughout this phase. So if you could just throw light on that.
No, that's, I mean, I think I'll just repeat myself. So essentially that is the reason why I have chosen the subject. And, you know, I thought that's a compelling story. This is the first bank post-independence, that part of India, the entire eastern India. If you see the south, Kerala and certain pockets full up this thing. You have North Delhi, you have in Mumbai and Ahmedabad and all. But in the entire eastern India, Bhubaneswar, I mean, Orissa, Uttarakhand, Bihar, West Bengal, there is nothing. So in that, and this is full of shadow banks where not giving money, but taking people's money under various things. Either way, no, these are so-called CIS, that collective investment schemes. The Shardas and Rose Valleys and all, the total, I think SEBI has closed about 300 odd such schemes, and maximum most of them are for Eastern India. So there people lost lost money. But Bandhan, actually its risk is their risk, because they are giving money, not taking money. So that is why I thought it's a compelling story. And as I said, this is not a story about romanticizing microfinance, because all the popular books on microfinance, I would not name them, there you found they're written by people who are involved themselves. They all project themselves as a romantic hero. You know, something out of the world they're doing, they are becoming messiah for the poor. I found that's not correct way of approaching it. It's a simple business. Indian banking sector is inefficient and incapable of reaching out to the masses and the so-called bottom of the pyramid. So here is a gentleman who takes the risk and he does everything to reach out to them. He makes money available for that particular segment and he keeps a larger spread because of the risk involved, and he could manage the risk well, and he benefits himself and thousands of his employees. So people who started with 2,000, 3,000 rupees salary in 2002, now earning lakhs, now driving cars, now having their own houses. And of course, the entrepreneurs, the women groups of, I mean, individual women also, they form a group and all, who were taking 5,000 rupees or 3,000 rupees, 2002 and 3, now they are taking 1.5 lakh, 2 lakh, right. And they themselves are employing people. So it is changing people's life. But not a social work. It's a purely case of business.
Yeah. I'm not going to ask Tamalda to share all the stories, but there's tons of wonderful anecdotes, that little idiosyncrasies, where he'll mention the color of somebody's motorbike. While Ghosh's motorbike was a black Bajaj Boxer, to his colleague Samantha, who had a red Bajaj Boxer.
No, that's I told you, no. So, that's the entire idea that people must see them.
Correct.
Which I got through the process I told you. How correct. I get this idea to do that. Huh?
He also, as in like you mentioned, he also emerges as a tough negotiator with SIDBI, with ASA. He breaks out an old relationship with ASA. He negotiates with SIDBI, IFC, very, very this. But at the same time, you also get a flavor of someone who wants to do something different. He's also embedded that into his employees. There's a wonderful anecdote, and you know I've asked you to share the anecdote because that's the anecdote that probably reaches out the whole Bandhan spirit. Halima Begum, that one employee who went to meet Halima Begum. If you could just share that one anecdote as a picture from your book, that would be great.
That's the lady that you're talking about, the blind lady? Someone?
No, the lady whose house he went and sat at from 11 to 6.
Okay, no. Okay, that's about one particular border, but I'll put you two small things
right.
Which showed what kind of character is this gentleman, Mr. Chandrasekhar Ghosh. So he is there, one of his employees, his name is Partha Samanto, he is one of the first employee. He goes to his house in the morning one day on a holiday. And he find his boy sitting in the drawing room, and he said that my dad is in the bedroom, don't disturb him now, something like that. So they said, who is your mom? He said, mom is also in the bedroom. Then he said, what's happening? In the, 10 o'clock, so he's sitting there for about an hour and all. And then he found the bedroom doors opens, and three of them, Mr. Ghosh, Mrs. Ghosh, and one gentleman coming out. And this gentleman was teaching Mr. and Mrs. Ghosh spoken English. So he comes on Sundays and takes 1 hour class, spoken English, to teach this lady and Mr. Ghosh how to speak English because he was not good in English.
Correct.
So that's one, his crave for knowledge how to do that. And second part, which I, as an advisor, was thickly involved in certain area till the launch, I saw it. When this ONM Piyush Pandey was doing the branding of this, so they did a film which will be shown in the on the television channels, etc., about Bandhan. So in the boardroom, they showed the film. And then, of course, they were discussing that how they have done other films, and those films have got some awards, so on and so forth and all. So Mr. Ghosh said, first of all, he said, look, you get the award, but what is there for me? I mean, you are doing a film and you are getting awards, so you are getting kudos, but I have to figure out whether I am getting the benefit out of it and all. Show me the film. So they showed the film, and all the top people showed the film and all. And then when it got over, Mr. Ghosh pressed the bell, and he asked his secretary, can you send these two gentlemen? Who are the two gentlemen? His driver and the tea boy of that particular floor. And they came, and they did not know what they expected out of them. In a boardroom, all the senior executives sitting there, the tea boy walks in and the driver walks in. They never had seen before, they've never gone to the boardroom before. Of course, tea boy has gone to serve tea. And they said, better. So they sat, they're not sitting, they're very reluctant. He said, no, you sit. Abhi dekho ek film dekhana hai, unko film dekhao. So then the film was showed. And then he asked him in Bengali, what have you understood? When they gave the certificate that they have understood the film, then Mr. Ghosh said, yes, this film is okay. So because he knows that he needs to reach out to this kind of people who are their borrowers who are involved. So that's his way of doing things. It's not, my senior executives are fine with the film and so it is good. Or the maker of the film said he has got so many awards, so it is good. No. The tea boy and my driver, who represent my clientele.
Correct.
If they understand the film, then only it is good.
Thank you for that. Because you mentioned your advisory role, there is an ethical issue which wasn't there with the first two books. A lot of people were very, as in, even at your launch when I was there, a lot of people brought it up. How difficult is it, and how do you defend yourself against the fact that, Bandhan is a story that you're telling because, well, you're part of it, you're benefiting from telling that story, it's a journey you're part of. How do you manage that ethical issue and stay professional?
Yeah, I think this issue or the dilemma is in all three the books and all. I don't see any problem, any change as far as my role is concerned. Only difference is this, in the first two cases, I was an outsider. I I had to get the story through narrations of many people, meeting them, etc., etc. And in this case, I am an outsider insider.
You're embedded.
I am not embedded in the sense I am not with Bandhan from 2002.
Oh.
I have gone into Bandhan in 2015, that too in an advisory role, not on a regular employee role. So I have seen it from inside. To some extent, I have seen it from, so to that extent, it is different. But the basic tenet is the same. Is it a sponsored book by the entity? No. Have I taken 1 rupee from any of them? No. Have I shown them the script, how it is written? No. Have I listened to them and knocked up everything what they did not want? No. So it's the same the treatment. As I said, you have to be clinical, you have to be objective. And when I approached Kaushik Basu, who was the former Chief Economic Advisor of India and then World Bank Chief Economist, he asked me, he raised the same issue. He said, look, you are somehow a part of Bandhan. I said, you read it, and if you are convinced, then only you write the foreword, because you are also lending your name to the book. And he read it, and he said, absolutely fine. It could not have been better. So he has done that. So I don't think I have done, there is a question of any ethics issue here. As long as I know what I'm going to do, and as I said, as long as I'm very clinical in my approach, and as long as there is no financial relationship is there, I don't see any problem whatsoever there.
I'm going to now ask you to bring out your crystal ball as someone who's been looking at the banking sector and writing about the banking sector. Small finance banks, is the party for the MFIs over? Standalone MFIs, is that party over? Also, fintech coming in a big way, including for small loans, especially in the urban areas. Do you think these two things are going to change how banking works? A lot of people are out there writing epitaphs for banks already.
I think who said that? Is Bill Gates? I think Bill Gates said that the bankers will die, banking will remain. So this is a cliche, but yes, we are at a crossroads. We are seeing a lot of changes. And till recently, we used to say that Indian financial system is essentially bank-led system, but suddenly we are saying, no, it's no more bank-led. The non-banking finance companies are playing a very critical role. So I think it will change, but I don't think it will change overnight. The scope, the banks will of course remain, and the banks will need to change, which, say for instance, HDFC is changing very fast, the way it has been changing. So there is no difference between a fintech and HDFC in that sense, the way it's going. And many of them are going. And those who are not able to change themselves, they will become irrelevant. Some of the public sector banks will become, and they will probably, government need to do certain things about them. But otherwise, the basic thing, you need money as a loan, and you need money you need to save. And the banking system will remain. Also the microfinance will remain at least in the foreseeable future, maybe in the next 5 years or so, because even the small banks, the market is so large, the demand is so huge, and there is so much, so many people are still uncared for, untouched by the banking system. I don't see, that small finance bank ringing a death knell for the microfinance institutions. All. What will happen is this: some of the microfinance, some of the small finance will become universal bank. Some more microfinance will become small banks. So this kind of transition will continue to happen over the next few years, maybe one more decade or so, before we actually say what's going to happen.
Consolidation also in MFI space?
No, people have been talking about Bharat Financial, which is SKS, has been up for sale, which
Correct.
Somebody else will buy out. You have seen Kotak has bought someone.
IDFC Bank.
IDFC has bought someone. Yes, smaller guys are being bought over. Yes, there are, because it's a nice way to build. I mean, if the franchise is good,
Correct.
This is the way to approach. You can either merge with yourself, or you can treat them as a sort of banking correspondent within the group. So there is synergy. So what is going to see is this: the synergy that which the banking sector was refusing to explore, now it will happen more. So you'll have a bank and fintech and MFI and NBFCs, those kind of at various level, somebody will the originate your business and pass it on to you, somebody will take the risk, somebody will take the fees, etc., etc. So we'll find a lot of interesting combinations, a lot of new alliances, a lot of new synergies will be explored. But and some of the existing old public sector banks probably would become irrelevant very fast.
My last question, when do we get to see your next book?
Actually, I had certain ideas and I was planning to start, but then so many things happening in the financial sector, I always run the risk of being outdated by the time the book comes out. So, I am on it. I mean, hopefully next year I should, next year meaning 2018, not 17, I should have that on.
As long as I'm invited to a launch, I'm fine with that. But any questions from the... From the people? Any questions? Yeah.
While payment banks are not supposed to be in the business of giving loans, but however they can certainly source loans and get others to sort of serve loans. So, and especially payment banks, the way just one payment bank in 1 week has created 1.5 lakh new banking points, and we have so many other big players still in the pipeline. What's your view? Is banking really going to change, and is banking going to be completely demystified, at least for the individuals? It's going to be so simple where bagal ka panwala is where you do your banking rather than step into an air-conditioned bank branch?
Well, you know, and this is a real-life example. Last week, I stepped into one bank branch, my bank branch, after a long time, I don't know how many years, and for something related to a mortgage at 7:30 in Bombay, and I found only the bank branch manager sitting, nobody else was sitting, and he was on his computer. So I asked him, sab kya kar rahe abhi sab, 7:30 and everybody else has left and all, and he told me in Hindi, if I roughly translate this into English, it says that, sir, kya hal hai aaj ka din mein? You go to market and you buy a shooting or whatever from Raymond's, because Raymond stands for a benchmark of good quality. But you give it to a village tailor to stitch a suit. So what is going to happen? What will be the quality of the suit? He said, apna halat, he is telling himself about himself, mera halat aisa hai, aur mera jo 19 employees hai yahan pe, uska bhi halat aisa hai. We have given certain things, we don't know how to use them. So you people talk about new instrument and fintech and banking on your mobile and doing things and all, but we are grappling the ideas, we are the village tailors, and we don't know how to stitch a Raymond suit. So you're talking about the demystifying for the customers. First it needs to be demystified for the bankers themselves. So I think it's a long way. A lot of, like, people are talking about Bitcoin and blockchain and ledger money and all. Do you know what is the volume of blockchain, that particular currency in India? Anybody's guess? It started post-Lehman in 2010, it started globally. Globally, it's about $200 billion. In India, 2 crore. I'm talking about volume, total trade and everything put together. So it's more noise than what's happening and all. But yes, of course, it's changing the way banking is done. The different, I'm talking about the changes are going to happen at the transaction space, not in the instrument space, like the savings and deposits and loans, etc. They remain the same, but how do we do it? That intermediation, that transaction, will you carry your bank on your, or will you do it on your internet, or what are the things or the next provisions stores, will it have that app there? These are the issues now we are grappling with, and we will see, and things are unfolding. As far as payment banks are concerned, not too many people are very sure about their business model, because they are not allowed to give loans. They can only take deposits, and 75% of the deposits need to be invested in government bonds, 25% with other banks. Now one particular payment bank is offering 7.25 or 7.5 for savings bank, and also 1 minute talk time free per rupee. Now look at the 10-year bond. Where do you invest that money? So it's always a negative carry for your money. So there are apprehensions. What is the right business model for the payment bank? Which is why out of 11, I think 3 have already dropped out. And probably you will not even see 8. There are rethinks and all. So probably this will help particularly the telcos to ring fence their existing business and to thwart competition, so that you have the thing and all. And those who are not in that space, for them it will be very difficult to find out the right business model.
Payments Bank 3 have dropped out. Vodafone and Idea, if they merge, another one will go down. So from 11, you're down to 7. So out of 11 licenses issued, you're down to 7 already. The deadline ends at the end of this month. So
our deadline also, I think.
Yeah. Any last questions? Anybody? One last call out?
Okay. Sir, I will make it very short, because this lady has given enough hint to the moderator. First of all, I don't know why people are very surprised that why SKS did not get. Because the licensing norm categorically says that if there is any issue against you in terms of investigation, etc., you would not be get. And the kind of history SKS has, I'm talking about the SKS of the past, not now and all. So its track record, I mean, regulator cannot be so forgetful, you know, what you have done in the past. So certainly SKS not giving the license, I don't think it is a surprise. That's point number one. And point number two is this, as far as other microfinance becoming a bank and their challenges, yes, their challenge will be on the deposit side from the beginning, because they need to now raise money. I mean, I'm talking microfinance turning into small banks, because they need to raise money from public and support their own loans. They cannot continue to take bank loans and do that and all. So that's the challenge. But the pure play microfinance, which are taking money from banks and lending them, keeping a spread, they will continue to be there, because there is a massive market which is unattended by banks. And under Indian banking law, 40% of your loans need to be given to the so-called priority sector. Banks are not able to do that, the foreign banks and many of the private banks. So they would need a vehicle to give the money. So they will continue to give money to the good microfinance entities. It will take a while, because SFBs first need to know the art of collecting money. They don't know. They know the art of giving money, but they don't know art of collecting money. How do you do that? How do you do that? Because your guys cannot do that. They only know how to collect the loan, not to collect deposits. So that it will take a few years to learn. Yeah, they have the all other things around.
Thank you, panelists. May I now request Mr. Vinod Nair to come up on stage and give away the mementos.